can read the history of Ireland on the skyline. It's like an ancient manuscript with its figuration of towers and castles. Here are the shapes and outlines of the centuries past. And down those centuries, the builders were adventurers, monks and warriors. They built their towns, as in Limerick, on the banks of the rivers, where horses could ford, where the countryside could be dominated from. This Limerick skyline is more than 1,000 years old, a manuscript that meanders from the medieval to the modern, that borders the majestic Shannon River, which defines and delineates this ancient city. St. Mary's from the 12th century, King John's from the 13th century, and now a new castle for a new generation of warriors rising on the skyline, Thomond Park Stadium. Like the jaws of some gigantic prehistoric animal, the new Thomond stares defiantly skyward. It seems to say, enter here at your own peril. Already they have nicknamed it the Clam. Maybe it's the mouth of hell. Now there are thousands of new seats, corporate boxes, bars, restaurants, fitted carpets, air conditioning. The cement floors, the whitewashed walls, and the smelly jacks of another era has been replaced by polished furniture and elegance. The magnificent success of Munster has turned what was once the name of an Irish province into a world-recognized rugby brand, unique, heroic, and envied across the world. Munster, Munster. The name has now become as evocative as any of the underwater bells that ring in the Irish imagination. Walk now into any rugby club in the world and say Munster out loud, and listen to the respectful silence fall. This began in 1940, when Europe went to war. Thomond Park was open for provincial matches and as permanent homes for the historic Limerick clubs, Bohemians and Shannon. One Shannon veteran recalls that when they first came here to Thomond Park to play a match, they had to bring two bags of turf to light the boiler, to heat the water, to have the showers. Very soon, Thomond began to develop its own personality. The former terracing and four sides of the pitch had local nicknames.
Where we are now, on the opposite side to the main stand, would have been the six-minute side. Behind me, we had the Belinenty end. It meant that guys could come hop on the wall and jump over the wall from Belinenty, it's a housing estate behind the Thomond Park, and get a view of the match. On the other side then, we call it a rather snob side, with the Maidstone end. I don't know what you call that in Dublin. I suppose the Hill 16 would be the Belinenty end, that would be the Havelock Square end. And then with the main stand over here behind me, you know, that was known as Pneumonia Stand or Pneumonia Park, because you get pneumonia in that stand with the breeze coming in off the Clare Hills.
Almost 30 years ago, in October 1978, the touring All Blacks came here and were beaten by Munster.
It's unbeaten on this tour so far, the 8th All Blacks to Thomond Park, strongly fancy them to beat Munster.
The moment opened up a seam into myth and legend.
The drop of goal, it's over!
1916 was the score when the Irish Republic was declared. 12-0 was the score when Munster beat the visiting All Blacks.
Very good run by Bone, and he's through into the 22. Brian Williams is there. Nicely taken by Munster, and this is a try. Munster have won. History has been made.
But Munster and this great new edifice are not just about rugby football. In a world where sport itself is rapidly becoming just another consumer product, and where sports stars are so frequently overpaid and overindulged mediocrities, the stadium is a temple to the old verities, a perpetual salute to the old values. The Irish poet Patrick Kavanagh once said that all great civilizations are built on the parish. Tell that to Munster. They understand that. Here the parish takes on the world and the parish wins.
Thomond Park is a great place to play, and especially like with a Munster team, when the crowd are behind us, you know, we would face anybody in that atmosphere.
This is the People's Republic of Munster Rugby.
Couple of yards short of the Wasps line. Munster trying for their first try, and they've got it! Picked up by Galway, and Galway surely will make the line from here. must get.
It's outstanding, you know, considering Wasps are one of the top sides in England, it's very encouraging for us.
Here the values of community and compatriotism reign supreme. Here the ethos of the modern age for ego and individualism are subsumed to the greater good. The good ship Munster still sails the high seas, fearlessly flying the flag of the old brigade.
And it's won again!
Everyone was so excited about seeing the Saracens. The manner in which we won the game as well was special, you know, with Vaj having to retake his conversion right at the end.
It's there!
When you look back on a night like that, I think that's why supporters keep coming back now, is to sort of relive moments like that.
Coleman Park deserves all the credit for being a fitting venue.
Coming from the small background that we have, and coming from the small stadium that was here, and the small team and the small budget we had, we're definitely moving in the right direction.
In a curious way, something quite extraordinary has been achieved here. You could call it a Munster solution to a Munster problem. They have managed to marry the demands of commercialisation for the modern professional game to the old ethics of amateurism. This is a magnificent, shiny new stadium. In fact, it's a monument to the relics of old decency. In the decades since the oval ball went professional, Munster have managed an economic miracle. On the edge of Europe and far from the great commercial waterways, they have survived and prospered where so many rugby icons have perished.
Well, we'd like to think that this is maybe history in the making. All we've done now is reach a semi-final. We've a little bit further to go yet before it's history.
But remarkable as their commercial success has been off the pitch, and their titles on the pitch, they've also won the respect and affection of the sporting world for something else that is quite intangible, something that is, well, pure Munster.
When I finish playing, I want to know that the time that I spent in the Munster jersey, that I did it proud. When people do get a chance to play for Munster, that they're making it as hard as possible for the next guy to get the jersey, because you know it's not going to be yours all the time. You're basically minding it for as long as you possibly can, and you want to make sure that the guy who comes in to takes it has earned it, you know, because it shouldn't be easy to play for Munster, and it's not, you know.
The silence that falls across Thomond Park when a visiting player is taking a kick is a reminder of how these fans remember the great global fellowship of sportsmanship. How ironic that a game once taught here in Limerick to the natives by a conquering army has now an independent island come to define them. Thomond Park then is a place of pilgrimage and celebration, the very heartbeat of the great Irish sporting tradition. No wonder that the songs they sing here, given our history, are songs of place, are songs of home, and are songs of passion. Lyrics of love and loss and renewal. All the endless passion of it all.